So the final talk of this session will be about implicit 3D orientation learning for 6D object detection, presented by Martin Sudenmayer. And this is work with Zoltan Martin, Maximilian Dörner, Manuel Brücker, and Rudolf Triebel.
Okay, thank you very much. Yeah, my name is Martin Sundermeyer. I'm from the Institute of Robotics and Mechatronics at the German Aerospace Center, and I will present implicit 3D orientation learning for 6D object detection from RGB images. So 6D object detection from RGB is really a fundamental task in robotics. It enables our robots to autonomously manipulate objects. It's also used for augmented reality applications. In our approach, we only need a 3D model and an RGB image. The task is to find an object in an image and determine the 3D translation and 3D rotation from camera to object coordinates. So there are a lot of challenges in this problem. For example, there are occlusions and clutter. We have illumination changes, textureless objects, and symmetries. These challenges are well captured in the TLS dataset on which we will test on. Our 6D object detection pipeline consists of three parts. First, a 2D object detector, here SSD, that detects all the objects in the images and outputs bounding boxes. The resulting object crops are fed into our augmented autoencoder, which will output an estimate of the orientation. Finally, we have a projective distance estimate that yields a full 6D pose. The focus in this work is on the augmented autoencoder. So a particular problem for learning-based approaches is that they usually require pose-annotated data. But pose annotations are really expensive to generate. We have done this. It is really time-consuming and requires a complex setup. An alternative is to train on synthetic data, for example, on a 3D reconstruction or a cut model. But then the challenge is to generalize to a real scene crop. Another challenge are pose ambiguities, especially for supervised learning approaches. A symmetric object like this one appears identical from opposite viewpoints, but labels are completely different. In this case, you can't learn a direct mapping from object views to pose labels because this is a one-to-many relation. Even if your object is non-symmetric, you can still have view-dependent symmetries as the popular cup example. Finally, there can be occlusion-induced symmetries as well. So to tackle these issues, we simply do not use pose labels during training. Instead, we encode synthetic object views uniformly sampled from SO3 using an autoencoder scheme. The goal is to learn an implicit representation of 3D object orientations in this latent space. However, how can we control what we encode? It could be object orientations, it could be also something else. So to investigate this, we did some minimal experiments. We encoded binary 2D squares in a two-dimensional latent space. And the goal is to find an encoding that changes continuously with the rotation of the square while being invariant to small translation and scale differences. So if we encode these squares after training, we get an encoding that has some Python, but it's not really continuous. And if we translate or scale these squares a little bit, the squares are encoded pretty randomly, which is expected because we didn't train with it. So of course we could include this random translation and scales during training, but then these factors are also encoded in the latent space. But we want to encode the rotation exclusively and become invariant to translation. So the solution is to still scale and translate the input squares, but keep the reconstruction target unscaled and centered. This makes the encoding invariant of translation and scale. Now, the latent dimensions actually resemble continuous sine and cosine functions, specifically encoding an implicit orientation. Also notice the fourfold frequency of the sine and cosine functions, which is because of the two symmetry axes of the square. So we introduce exactly the same strategy to encode 3D orientations. Our augmented autoencoder uses a randomization scheme to learn invariance against irrelevant factors. So in addition to the translation, we randomize also the light, the color, and we introduce random occlusions and backgrounds from the Pascal Wok dataset. Again, the reconstruction target stays clean, such that the most efficient encoding is invariant against all these factors. As a result, the encodings become robust to the domain gap between real and synthetic data. They become robust against occlusions, illumination changes, and clutter, and they specifically encode orientations. So our architecture is just a convolutional autoencoder with a 128-dimensional latent space. We determined the appropriate latent dimensions empirically. At 128, the dimension, the test performance saturates, and training takes about 3 hours per object on a GPU. So after training, the reconstruction of real images look like this. They are examples of the LineMod and the TLS dataset, and you can see how the augmented autoencoder is able to segment objects from the background. It can even reconstruct occluded parts of an object. So this figure shows the first three principal components of synthetic and real encodings, and these encodings come from images that are recorded from a view sphere. Equivalent object views produce similar latent codes independent of the domain. So how to predict the 3D object orientations? First, we create a big codebook of 92,000 encodings from object views of all over SO3. Online, we will detect an object and feed the scene crop into our encoder to generate one test code. And this test code is compared to all the training codes using cosine similarity. And the nearest neighbor here will give us the 3D orientation. So here are some examples of nearest neighbors. Notice that almost symmetric views are close together in the latent space, like this two. Finally, to obtain the full 60 poles, we employ a projective distance estimation based on the pinhole model. Therefore, we use the ratio between the real and synthetic bounding box diagonals at the predicted orientation. We also use the rendering distance and the camera intrinsics. So here are some qualitative results on TLS. On the left side, you can see our RGB-based 6D object detection. On the right side, you can see the same with an ICP refinement step. There's not a big visual difference. It's flickering a bit because there's no tracking involved. And finally, you can see that by observing the green box on the right, that sometimes the ICP is even worsening the results if there's occlusion. So in terms of numbers, in the RGB domain, we beat competing methods on the TLS dataset. In the depth domain, we are competitive if we initialize the ICP with our method. We are much faster than competing algorithms. The state of the art takes almost 5 seconds per target. The biggest challenge are strong occlusions. So to conclude, our main contributions are a real-time RGB-based 6D object detection pipeline and a new approach to encode 3D object orientations from RGB. It's fully learned from synthetic data, so we don't need any post-annotated images. It generalizes to various test sensors and does not suffer from ambiguous poses. So we will have a very small live demo now, I hope. You can change to the HDMI. Yeah, so this is running on a Jetson TX2. So you can see that this approach is really efficient. There's no tracking involved, that's why it's a bit flickering, but yeah, basically works quite well, even in real life, not only on data sets. Thank you very much.
Questions? Your demo was really nice, but you use a fairly uniform background.
Here in the demo?
For the object. So having the objects on a complicated background, would that create problems or not? The encoder doesn't care?
Yeah, like we saw this reconstructions from the test images. And you notice that the reconstruction is actually free from background. So it's able to segment the object from the background really well. Okay. I would say.
Okay. Anything else? Okay. Yes, somebody?
Hi. I hope you can hear me. Mm-hmm. So I wanted to ask if the object themselves have some kind of symmetries. How does that affect? Because there are pose estimation ambiguities involved in such cases.
Yes. So the goal is to not hurt the training process, basically, because in supervised learning settings, you have different labels to the same object view. And if you learn the mean, that might not be correct. And so when we are at test time, we just choose the nearest neighbor, which is one of the ambiguous poses. Because we can't tell, it's just the next one.
But it could be any of the, while test time, it could be any of the symmetric views.
Yes. You could also cluster them together to get all the symmetric views.
Okay. Thanks.
Okay, thank you. Let's thank the speakers again.
Thanks.
And this concludes the session.